Please be seated. And as you sit, hear these words from the Bible, words of hope. I am the resurrection, the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Can I give you all a very warm welcome today, whether you're here in church or watching at home, to this service of thanksgiving for the life of Steve Hare. We all want to express our love and concern for Christy and the children and their family and assure them of our love and prayers and our care for the days and months ahead. And we gather in the name of the crucified and risen Lord Jesus Christ to give thanks for Steve Hare, to commend him to God, our merciful Redeemer and Judge, and to comfort one another in our grief. And we do grieve. We don't understand why. But today we lean on Almighty Sovereign God, who is good, and cling to the certainty of resurrection hope. For Steve knew and trusted Jesus, and he is with Jesus. Hallelujah. What a hope. As Paul writes in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. Let us bow our heads and pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are the God of mercy and the Lord of all life. You have made us in your image to reflect your truth and light. And we give you great thanks for Steve, for all the ways you reflected your character and priorities. We thank you for your saving work in him. And as we gather today, we pray for Christy and the children and his parents and brothers and sisters and their families. Comfort and help them today and all who grieve. We thank you that your son wept at the grave of Lazarus, his friend, that Jesus was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief and can be near us now. Help us all today to know your presence and strength and comfort. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to sing together our first hymn that speaks of the glory of Christian hope, which is not vague, but rock solid and a huge comfort on a day like today. We stand to sing our first hymn, There is a Hope That Burns Within My Heart. Please stand.
Glory now revealed in me, the poor.
please be seated. And Charlie's going to bring a tribute to his dad.
Dad developed a game that quickly became a favourite in our house. He used it a lot, and we all got great joy from it, particularly when he used it on Monty or Imogen when they were being grumpy. He'd stop you in your tracks and say, "Hey, guess what?" To which the obvious response is, "What?" Dad would then smile, knowing he's got you, and reply, "I love you." Then you can't help but smile, even when you'd rather not, because you've got a point to prove. After some time, though, the younger ones clicked what was happening. So every time Dad said, "Guess what?" they skipped the what and went straight to, "I love you." Our dad loves us, and we love him for it. Dad loved his adventures, though Mum didn't always want to know the details. So when Dad sent Mum a selfie of him and Uncle Dan after a climb with a stunning view, Mum's reply was, "Excuse me, why do you have to wear helmets?" Dad kept it calm. "To look cool," he replied. In the summer of last year, we were able to get away on a family holiday, and while away, we went to a monkey park where we got to walk through enclosures with all sorts of exotic animals. In one of the enclosures were two big red parrots. I took some of the food given to us, and while attempting to feed these huge birds, I could hear Dad laughing from behind me. After a few attempts to call the parrots, I turned around to Dad as if to say, "What's so funny?" Dad continued to just laugh as he pointed to a sign showing a man being attacked by the parrots for doing exactly what I was doing. Our dad is hilarious, and we love him for it. Whatever the weather, whatever the time, Dad would be the one to take Jack and George up and down the country for their football matches. Never drawing too much attention to himself, he'd stand at the sideline, quietly cheering them on, but still making sure to mock them both for arguing with the ref after every single game. And when all of us cousins would go for a kickabout, we'd come back and boast to Dad about how one of us had scored the best goal ever, only for Dad to chuckle and mock us again, saying, "You say this every single time." Our dad is our biggest fan, and we love him for it. When I was about 11, I introduced Dad to an online game called Lord of Ultima. In this game, you manage cities and compete against other players and alliances across the world. We played it together for a while before it got too complicated for me, and I gave up. Not for Dad, though. Fast forward a year or so, and Dad was still playing Lord of Ultima, and had found himself ranked somewhere around the top 10 in the world. A few years later, I introduced Dad to another geeky game. In this one, we both sit at the table in our evenings, painting little model soldiers from space. I got a text from him one day saying that in the dining room, he'd managed to reserve us a shelf. Over time, subtly, he claimed more and more space, and now the whole shelving unit is covered by our nerdy work. Our dad is a nerd, and we love him for it. Learning to drive, Dad drew the short straw and took me and George out a lot. Whether it was hill starts or joining the dual carriageway, I'd always panic and say, "I can't do that." No matter how much stress there was in my voice, though, Dad's response was always the same, a very calm, "Yeah, you can." Annoyingly, he was usually right. And the same applied to maths or science homework at the dining table. Sat with Dad, sometimes for hours at a time, getting more and more frustrated at his refusal to just give us the answers. He'd calm us down and keep working through it. Our dad is our teacher, and we love him for it. I wish I could stay stood here for days and keep telling you all about everything that makes our dad so incredible. But there simply aren't enough words in existence. Our dad is our hero, our rock, our inspiration, and our best friend, and he is ours forever. Through Mum and Dad together, we have been taught how life should be lived, how a marriage should be built, how parenting should be done. And I know that myself, George, Jack, Monty, and Imogen will all be such great parents because of them. Hey, Dad, guess what? We love you. And until we meet again, we'll miss you every day. Thank you.
Thank you, Charlie. That was wonderful. We're going to listen now to a song that expresses Steve's children's appreciation for their dad. It'll be on the screens.
Son really tells his father how he really feels. A handshake or a pat on the back is all that he reveals. I'd like to right that wrong. He will miss a little song. Thank you for shaping my life. Thank you for teaching me all you can. You are no ordinary man, no, no, no. You make me everything I am. Thank you for taking the time. Thank you for showing me. Thank you for being my dad. thank him for being my dad.
That was worth waiting for, wasn't it? So beautiful, so beautiful. And I'll ask now members of Steve's family to come and to speak about Steve. Thank you.
All of us here have fond memories of Steve. We'd like to share just a few of our memories as a family and what Steve means to us. Steve was the second of Mum and Dad's children to be born, their eldest son. In his early years, he was always ahead of his age, reaching milestones early, crawling at 5 months, and climbing onto the dining room table not long after that. As a young child, there were two things he loved: jigsaw puzzles and tractors. He was seven when our family moved to Luton, from Luton to Crowborough at the end of 1988, where he went to Firmer School and then Beacon. Friends he made from both of these continued to be important to Steve throughout his adult life. He was a loyal, kind friend. His childhood and teenage years were strongly influenced by family life, and the importance of his own family life as it grew is testimony to that. Steve was clever. A science degree at Imperial College was followed by a PhD at Birkbeck. This was put to good use, first of all as a researcher at Imperial College, and then for the past 4 years as a lecturer and researcher at the University of Sussex. He would often try and explain what it was that he did, but unfortunately we weren't clever enough to always understand it. Steve's favourite part of his job at the University of Sussex was working with his students, especially mentoring them. He worked many additional hours to help them progress both academically and personally.
Dr. Stephen Hare, but still Steve, and he wasn't just clever academically, he was also very wise. He was often the go-to person in the family for advice. He was also always so humble and respectful of others. And his words were always said in love, a good example to us all. Steve was content and confident in who he was. You could always trust him to be genuine. He didn't take himself too seriously and had a great sense of humour. He didn't mind us laughing at his short shorts and bare feet. And he gave an amazing deep chuckle when something really amused him. His humbleness came across physically as well. Such a strong, physically fit guy, described by someone recently as the one person who could pretty much beat me at everything he turned his hand to, but was so humble and encouraging to all. We know those who walked, ran, and climbed with him will agree with the comment we've heard a good number of times: Steve's a machine. And he was always the first to help others when needed. He would often leave us amazed and sometimes amused at the various challenges he would undertake. He loved being part of a team, and he really enjoyed the camaraderie during his years at Crowborough Rugby Club. Steve loved spending time outdoors. As well as the more adventurous activities he did, he was also a keen gardener with varying degrees of success. One year, an abundance of pumpkins. Last summer, some amazing sunflowers. He also loved walking the dogs. And meeting Steve for dog walks was one of Mum's favourite things to do. Most of all, Steve loved spending time with his family. His enduring selfless love for Christy, Charlie, George, Jack, Monty and me is his greatest gift, and where we saw his character most fully.
Family man, humble, highly intelligent, wise, genuine, physically strong, respectful of others, and always encouraging others, especially younger ones. But there's one thing which lies behind all of those, and which we know he put first. The really important thing is life. His faith, it underpinned everything. Steve put his trust in Jesus at a young age and was baptized with Christy as a teenager. He was keen to be useful and to be involved with his church family and spent many years working with teenagers, both down at the Forest Fold Baptist Church and more recently here at All Saints. With Christy, he led the summer camps down at Forest Fold, impacting the lives of many young people. And although the family only moved to All Saints earlier this year, he had already joined the youth team here and was excited about the opportunities to share the gospel. He'd recently started the Sussex Gospel Partnership Saturday training course. But I want to close by using a photo. Thank you. It isn't Steve. It's James. Some of you will know him. Sitting here at the front, and he'll lead us as we pray shortly. James was the friend Steve was walking with. A month ago. Walking and talking about the God they both loved. You see, Steve knew. Steve knew the Jesus of the Bible. And so wanted others to do the same. He knew Jesus as his good shepherd, who cared for him throughout his life and made him the Steve we all knew. He knew that when he died, he would spend eternity in heaven. And that gave him his peace. Steve will be part of the Hare family for the rest of our lives. More importantly, he'll be part of God's family with us through eternity. As we remember how Steve was, we know that Steve still is. And although that doesn't take away any of the grief and pain of losing him now, we are so thankful that we can look forward to seeing him in heaven one day.
Thank you so much. And I can watch some more pictures of Steve and the sentiment of the song.
Tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. Just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, where God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. Just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world heroes come and go, where God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until God knows why, I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah.
We're now going to hear Psalm 23, and Dan's going to read that for us. Thank you, Dan.
The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his namesake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Well, Steve Hare was an extraordinary man. And the lovely thing about Steve is he would be the last person ever to see himself like that. He was humble, bright. He loved his wife and family deeply. And even though I only got to know him over the last 6 or 7 months, I was always struck by his warmth and his strong, convinced faith in the Lord and his big, big, enormous smile. The smile literally filled his whole face and always put me at ease when I spoke to him. And Steve was not a guy who was after the limelight. He didn't want all the attention. And as a follower of the Lord Jesus, he would want the focus today to be on his Saviour, Jesus. And for his family and friends to find our comfort and sure hope in him. The psalm we just read is a psalm that speaks of the comfort and the hope that is possible for all to have in life and in death through faith in the Lord Jesus. The psalm speaks of the great comfort that is available to all people, whoever we are, whatever we have done through Christ. It's a psalm of King David. He was a very powerful leader, but he knew there was a higher throne. There was a greater king, a shepherd to look after and to look to and to trust in. He could look to the shepherd of heaven and earth, the Lord of heaven and earth, the gracious, compassionate, merciful and mighty God. King David could say, when he wrote this psalm, that the Lord, this mighty God, is the one who shepherds and cares for me. And through faith in David's greater son, King Jesus, Steve Hare could say, the Lord is my shepherd. He is my God, my King, my Lord, my hope in life and death. Friends, there is no greater security and joy than that. To know the Lord God is with us and for us is the greatest thing. It's a relationship each of us were created for. A relationship in which we can say, verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. That doesn't mean that we get everything we want in life, but it does mean that those who trust in the Lord Jesus as the shepherd of their lives, they will never lack what they need, what their Father, what their Saviour Jesus knows they need. And the rest of this psalm unpacks what that looks like. The ways that God supplies abundantly to all his trusting people. So they do not lack what they really need. Three brief things to notice in this passage this morning. Three things the Lord provides so that we lack nothing. The first is provision through life. Did you spot in verses 2-3, how the Lord leads and provides for all the necessities of life? The psalm speaks of green pastures, quiet streams and waters. The shepherd, he causes them to rest, to lie down. He makes them approach quiet waters carefully, and he leads them faithfully in the right way. And he does it, we're told, at the end of verse 3, for his name's sake. The way the Lord leads and cares and provides for his people is to show us what he is like, to reveal his glory to us, his character. And he acts to bless and bring benefit to his sheep, his people. He cares for us. He refreshes their hearts and souls with his great truth and his presence and his mercy and his love. And Steve Hare knew that. And even though the Lord has taken Steve home, the Lord will not stop working to provide for Steve's family in the days and the months ahead. To lose Steve does not make any sense to us at all. It is a mystery. But it does not mean that the Lord does not care, that the Lord will not provide for his family. He has not abandoned them. Now, when we say the Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing, it means that he will not stop giving his sheep, his children, this family what they need. And let's keep praying for that peace and confidence for each other and for Steve's family, in knowledge that the shepherd king provides throughout life. The second thing he gives his sheep is this: security in whatever happens. As we move from this picture in verse 2 and 3 of the abundant provision, we move to a verse that talks about the tougher seasons of life. Verse 4. The reality is, we all know, don't we? It's true that in life there is sunshine and storm. There is joy and there is sorrow. And verse 4 describes the sorrow and difficulty that God's people face as the darkest valley. Or it could be translated, the valley of the shadow of death. For death and darkness and difficulty are the reality for all people. And that's where we are right now, isn't it? In this dark valley of grief and shock and pain. Well, what difference does knowing the Lord is our shepherd and not lacking what we need make in the valley of the shadow of death? Well, without Christ, there is no relief. There is no comfort. There is so much to fear. And yet with Christ, we can say, I will fear no evil. We all have said, haven't we, in our hearts and to each other, I don't understand why. Why now? Why have you allowed this, Lord? It's such a mystery. And all those emotions are real for us. And we can take them to the Lord in faith as we lament and we grieve. And yet as we do, we need not fear. I will fear no evil. The shadow of death and gloom and sorrow is painful and real. But we need not fear the future for Steve or for ourselves. Why? Because the believer is never on their own. We have the Lord, the mighty, glorious Lord of heaven and earth with us and for us. That's verse 4. I will fear no evil, for you are with me. There's nothing more needed, my friends. Nothing more wonderful than the Lord with us. I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Like a good shepherd using their staff to guide the sheep in life. Or to bat away with a rod enemies in life. The Lord is with us. With the Lord as our shepherd, we can know security in life because he is with us and will never leave us nor forsake us, and his loving care comforts us. We can say, the Christian can say, we lack nothing because the mighty sovereign God, the shepherd, gives us so much provision in life, security in life, whatever happens. And thirdly and finally, eternal life in heaven. That's verse 6, isn't it? Surely your goodness and your love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You see, through the ups and downs of life, God's people can be assured that his goodness, his love, will pursue us and follow us and keep us. And he will take us one day to dwell with him in heaven, with the Lord forever. Now, friends, that is a game changer today, isn't it? That changes everything on a day like today, that the Lord who loved and saved Steve, who surrounded him with his love and goodness, is now home with his shepherds forever. That is our utter confidence. It's our conviction today. You see, when Jesus describes himself in John's Gospel, he says this: I am the good shepherd, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Jesus was sent into the world to make it possible for people like you and me, sinners, to be brought to know God as our Lord and our Shepherd and our Saviour forever. Jesus walked the valley of the shadow of death as he was nailed to the cross, and he bore the punishment we deserve. He walked the door marked death, that deep, deep valley of death, and gloriously, 3 days later, he rose again. He defeated death, and he said, "I am the resurrection, the life. Whoever believes in me, though they die, will live. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." And that is the promise that Steve was trusting in. What was Steve's hope in life and death? Christ alone. What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone. Christ alone. Jesus is the good shepherd, through whom we can know the Lord God as our Father. Jesus is the good shepherd who loved us and gave himself for us. And Steve knew that. And by God's grace, that means that Steve is with the Lord now. And as we who grieve today, we find huge comfort in this valley of grief right now. Friends, if we don't know this shepherd, Steve would love you to know him, to come to Jesus right now and trust in him for your future and your life. He welcomes all who come to him to seek his forgiveness and grace and care. Seek the Lord as your shepherd. Turn to him. Trust in him. And like Steve and so many here, you can know that we will lack nothing that we need. Provision in life. The Lord's constant presence and care. His glorious promise of life eternal. When there'll be no more sorrow, no more tears, no more goodbyes. We can't wait for that, can we? Christy shared with me some words that Steve had written for a talk, a Bible study he was leading at Forest Fold Young People's Group, the YP group. And these are Steve's words I'm going to read now on Psalm 23. And I'll finish my address with what Steve said to those young people all those years ago. Steve wrote, "Because Jesus has already gone through death into the grave and back out again, alive and glorious, we know that we will too. Death for us is nothing more than a doorway that we will pass through on our way into heaven. And whether it comes sooner or later, it doesn't really matter." Amen. I'll ask James to come and lead the prayers.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we come into your presence now because of what Jesus has done for us. We praise you, Almighty God, because of what you've done for us through Jesus. We know that just as we are in your presence now, Steve is in your presence because of what Jesus has done for him. Almighty God, we thank you for all and everything that Steve was and is. And we know that Steve was enabled to be the father that we've heard about, the husband that we know. We thank you, O Lord God, that he was these things because of who he was in Christ. Naturally, no one's humble. Steve was and is through Christ. His intelligence, his wisdom, his being a genuine, loving friend to so many was because of Jesus. Oh Lord God, Steve pointed us and is pointing us to Christ. And as we are here and now, and as there is pain and darkness, and as the psalmist called it, that dark valley of the shadow of death, O Lord God, may Jesus Christ comfort Christy and Charlie and George and Jack and Monty and Imogen. O Lord God, their father, from them was their rock. Steve was alongside Christy through thick and thin. And now, Heavenly Father, we're asking ourselves a question, why? But we know, and we've been reminded, that the valley of death can be walked through with Jesus. Give the family Jesus. May the family know the Lord Jesus Christ, comfort and hope. And those that know you as their Savior, may their faith grow in depth. And may those that don't come to know that special love. For Alan and Jean, the brothers, the sisters, the nephews, the nieces, the uncles, the aunts, the church family, friends, the colleagues, the teammates. So many of us here with a huge hole in our life because we're not going to see Steve's smile again in this life. We come to you and we beg you for the comfort that you alone can give. Almighty God, we're empty. We're drained. We just have not got the answers. We beg you for a fresh knowledge of what Jesus has done. And as you, Almighty God, as our Heavenly Father, gave your Son to give us hope, we pray that through this day, through our being pointed to Christ, through this congregation being gathered here to remember Steve's life and give thanks to you, we pray, O Lord God, that Steve's desire, that any that don't know you today as their Heavenly Father would come to know you through the Lord Jesus Christ. And then in some small sense, a little light would come in our lives and we would see some sense in what we don't understand. Heavenly Father, please continue to be with the family. Bless them. Uphold them, strengthen them, and may they know you as their shepherd. And as their shepherd, may they lack nothing. And may each and every one of us to be able to look forward to dwelling in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you, James. We're going to join together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. They're there on your service card. They'll be on the screens. If you'd like to pray them with us, please do. And so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Well, there's always many things to give thanks to God for. We've given thanks to God for Steve. Many reasons to bless the Lord in life and in death. Let us stand to sing our final song of praise, 10,000 Reasons. Bless the Lord, O my soul. We stand to sing.
His holy name.
After this, we will have we'll take Steve out of the church, and there with a burial at Herne Road. You're very welcome to come. Details are on the notice sheet, the service card to join us for the burial. Let me pray. So, our loving God, strengthen us with your love and your hope and your presence. Lift our eyes to you, our good shepherd in the darkest valley. Be our helper and hope this day. Amen. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and those you love this day and forevermore. Amen.
I'm sorry that I left you. I know you feel alone, but God told me that he needed me. He called me to come home. In what seemed to be an instant, in the twinkling of an eye, an angel gently took my hand and led me toward the sky. As I ascended into heaven, beyond the pearly gates. Angels were rejoicing, then I saw his radiant face. God's eye shone down upon me from the glory of his throne. He said, enter into paradise, 'cause heaven's now your home. I fought the fight, I finished the race. Throughout the trial, I kept my faith. No longer do I suffer, my body's been made whole. I'm flying with the angels, and heaven's now my home. God told me not to worry, he said you'd be okay, because eternity's forever, and we'll meet again someday. I fought the fight, I finished the race. Throughout the trial, I kept my faith. No longer do I suffer, my body's been made whole. I'm flying with the angels, and heaven's now my home. I'm flying with the angels, and heaven's now my home. I'm sorry that I left you, I know you feel alone, but God told me that he needed me, he called me to come home. In what seemed to be an instant, in the twinkling of an eye, an angel gently took my hand and led me toward the sky. As I ascended into heaven, beyond the pearly gates, angels were rejoicing. Then I saw his radiant face. God's eye shone down upon me from the glory of his throne. He said, enter into paradise, 'cause heaven's now your home. I fought the fight, I finished the race. Throughout the trial, I kept my faith. No longer do I suffer, my body's been made whole. I'm flying with the angels, and heaven's now my home. God told me not to worry, he said you'd be okay, because eternity's forever, and we'll meet again someday. I fought the fight, I finished the race. Throughout the trial, I kept my faith. No longer do I suffer, my body's been made whole. I'm flying with the angels. angels, and heaven's now my home. I'm flying with the angels, and heaven's now my home.